Well, good morning, Kettlebrook family. Troy here with Steve and Martha Farina this morning. We're so glad to have you join us in our virtual gathering. We at Kettlebrook are a family of followers of Jesus, helping others follow Jesus. And want to say special thanks to those of you who have put in since last week. Ryan and Dave asked for you to put in, submit to info@kettlebrook.org, the ways that God is speaking to you through Scripture. So thank you for those of you who have been able to do that. It's been very encouraging for us to get that. Also want to let you know that if you're watching us and you're not yet connected in a smaller sense to maybe one of our missional communities or small groups or really anyone else, I would love you to fill out a virtual connect card. I know it's hard in this time to connect, but we'd love to begin the process of connecting with you. And so you'll see a link at the bottom here to do that. It should be in either on the webpage if you're watching it through the kettlebrook.org or at the bottom of the YouTube under the description there. So this morning we are in a series called Equipped. Yeah, Equipped. And we're praying that you're being equipped as we go through this. We are this morning going to talk about being equipped in prayer. And one of the things that struck me was something I recently heard through the prayer course, which we're going to talk about a little bit later. But Peter Gregg talks in there about how the word prayer, it actually comes from the Latin word prayer is precarious, or it comes from precarious, and it means obtained by entreaty. And so when you think about the situation that we're in right now, it's a precarious situation to some extent. And how much more then should we be reminded to go back to prayer? The reason that I asked Steve and Martha to join me this morning is because if anyone's been around Kettlebrook for the past few years, they know that the heartbeat of prayer that you two have and how that's influenced us as a family that I am extremely grateful for. And so I almost couldn't help but say, Steve and Martha, can you please join me as we talk about prayer? And so I'm so blessed to have both of you with me this morning, with us this morning. And so in light of that, Martha, can I ask you to open us in prayer?
Yes. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time where we can come together as a family, albeit virtually, but it's wonderful to be able to be together, learning and worshiping and just being in church in our homes, having time with you. Lord, I pray that today as we learn a bit maybe about prayer, that you would open our ears to the things that you want to say to each of us individually, that you would put into our minds what our next steps are and how you mean to encourage each of us. Again, we just thank you for this time together, and we pray that you would be blessed in it and that your name would be glorified. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good. And so next we'd like to have a song with Dave and Abby Gerhardt are going to lead us in Be Thou My Vision. And I love how they are such a nice complement to each other. So let's sing the song, Be Thou My Vision.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that Thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, Thy presence my light. Be Thou my wisdom and Thou my true word. I ever with Thee and Thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father and I Thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with Thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance now and always. Thou and Thou only first in my heart. High King of heaven, treasure thou art. High King of heaven, my victory won, may I reach heaven's joys, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler.
So our text for this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17. And the verses are verse 14 through 21. And as we've been doing every week, we want to continue to do, because we want to equip you to be in the Word in your own homes. We'd like you to hit pause, read through this text maybe a couple times, and answer the questions that are come up on the screen before we move on and dig into this text with you. So go ahead and take a second and do that.
Well, one of the things that I miss about our gatherings is the kids. And what I'm so excited about is that today we have a chance again to have the kids read the scripture passage for us and share with us. I miss my all-stars. Can't wait till we have that time together again. The little boys and girls and the families coming. It's outstanding. So let's listen as the kids read for us this passage of scripture.
Please pray with me. Dear Lord God, thank you for your word. Please give us ears to hear and understand it. May you increase our faith. Thank you that you are always with us. Amen. Please stand with me as I read Matthew 17, 14 through 21. The healing of a boy with a demon. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. O unbelieving and perverse generation, Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I have to put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing will be impossible for you. But this kind does not go out except by prayer.
Hopefully, family, you've had a chance to not only hear it from the children, but to have a chance to read through it and spend some time in this text yourself. Now, we've spent some time in this as well, and it's an interesting text. It's not a text that you find at Hobby Lobby put up on. There's some hard questions and comments and things that come out of this text. Steve, give us a little bit of some of the context of what we're reading here in Matthew 17.
Well, it's Matthew, and so he's a Jew, and he's writing to his fellow Jews as his intended audience. And I think one of the things that's amazing about this is he doesn't pull any punches. There are some hard things that are said here. One of the things to realize is Matthew was part of this group of nine disciples who were approached by a crowd and a man who wanted his son to be healed of a demon. Now, just a note about that, the son with the demon is he showed some signs of epilepsy,
yep.
But the man himself said that the demon sometimes cast the child into the fire, sometimes into the water to drown. We have a grandson who's epileptic. That's never happened.
Sure.
So we know that this is not necessarily an epileptic seizure as much as it's a demon that's manifesting itself in epilepsy and in other ways.
We know from Matthew chapter 4 that there's a delineation between, Jesus is able to delineate between things that are illnesses,
yes,
or disorders, if you would, and demonic possession.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So in this case, it's this demonic possession, which I know sounds weird to some of you, but we're reading scripture, this is what Jesus was dealing with.
It's what it says.
Yeah.
So the challenge is, here are nine disciples, Jesus is not there, he's off with three other disciples on the mountain, And now there's this crowd and the man asking for the healing of his son. And the disciples are feeling that pressure, it really seems. And so they cannot get that demon out. And so Jesus shows up to the crowd, and the crowd runs up, and the man himself runs up to Jesus, says, "Lord, can you help me?" Falls on his knees. "My son has this demon. Your disciples could not. Can you help me?"
Yeah.
And it's at that moment that Jesus says, that's a really hard thing to understand. He says, "Oh, you perverted and unbelieving generation. How long am I going to put up with you? Bring him to me." And it's at that moment that you're like, oh, man. But Matthew seems to be saying in the text, that unbelieving, that perverted generation, that's me too.
Yeah. Yeah. There's another version of this same account in Mark and Luke, but Matthew seems to bring out his own take on this because he was one of the guys that was there and couldn't make this happen. So he's kind of like, hey, I think he's identifying with that. Now, what happens then after that is that the disciples are able to pull Jesus aside privately, I think with their tail between their legs a little bit,
yep.
And they're like, "Hey, Jesus, remember what just happened out there? You remember that? Why? Why couldn't we do this?" And then he says another kind of harsh thing where he's like, "Well, it's because your lack of faith, your little faith," which also sounds kind of harsh. But then there's this hope in there where he basically says, if you have the faith of just even a mustard seed, you can move mountains. So there's this inspiration in the midst of what seems like a little bit of a chastisement, which it's not. I think it's meant to point them towards this hope that we've seen here. But as we've been looking through this, and as you were reading this, you probably found some of the tensions that we were just talking about. And we noticed a number of them. Martha, one of the first ones that we kind of noticed and we talked about was, so why? What was going on? Why didn't this happen? Well, you know, that's the question, the first question we ask. What happened or why didn't it happen, right?
Right. I think they must have been so confused as they had already just gone out and cast out demons and healed people, and here they were again and ready to do the same thing, and then it didn't work.
Yeah.
And we might ask, where is Jesus in this? Is this about the disciples? Or is this about Jesus?
Yeah.
They were looking at themselves saying, what did we do wrong? Or maybe they were thinking, Jesus, why didn't you make this happen? Maybe they were blaming him. But they were very obviously confused about it. One thing we can think about is when they were sent out to heal and to cast out the demons, that was really a good training course for them to be able to realize that Jesus really had given them the power to do those things. That was amazing, and they could experience that and know that in Jesus' name they had the power to cast out demons and to heal people.
Yeah.
This is another piece of their training now. They are learning something else, and Jesus is telling them, this one only comes out by prayer and fasting. So it's the next part of their training. They're learning that. But we know that even with prayer and fasting, there are those prayer requests that don't get answered.
Yeah, which brings up yet another tension, right, Steve?
Yeah, it's the tension of he makes the statement, the littleness of your faith. And I think sometimes as Christians, we can be judgmental of each other, and we can say, well, Martha got an answer to prayer, but Steve did not. Steve, Martha has faith, you don't.
Sure.
And so it's like, oh, I've got to have muster all this faith, to have faith. And like as if there was a faith meter in heaven, you know.
Right.
And that's not the intention. The intention is that we would demonstrate faith, and it's Jesus' work to take the smallest faith, like you talked about, like a mustard seed, and he will do great things with it. The holding people to what happens around them, I mean, Martha gave great examples of sometimes the prayer is answered, sometimes it's not.
Yeah.
You're gonna punish. We're gonna judge one another when the prayer isn't answered. Is it on me? No, it's not.
Yeah.
It's for Jesus to decide. It's for Jesus to make it happen. It's for Jesus to decide whether he can answer it like we thought or in a completely different way. So the littleness of your faith, it's all Jesus is asking. Come on, guys, just a little faith. Trust me is really what he's saying.
Yeah, which brings up another tension that we talked about that I feel like I see in here indirectly. And this is it's this idea that prayer is God equipping us by stripping us. Prayer is God equipping us by actually stripping us. I think the image that I shared with you guys was this idea of sometimes we think about being equipped. We think about getting a backpack, and you know, if we're going to go on a trip or whatever, we get equipped and we have what we need in our backpack. I think of my son Ephraim, quite frankly, my youngest son. He's a tiny little guy. He's strong, but he's tiny. And so when we send him off to school, the first day of school, and you got everything he needs in his backpack for him, he's equipped, ready to go. He's going up the hill, the McLean like this, you know, ready to tip back over because his backpack's so full and so huge. Yeah. I think when it comes to prayer, what God is saying, let me equip you by completely stripping you of everything else that you think that you need, taking that small nugget of faith, that small mustard seed, and bring in that, and I will do immeasurably more you can ask or imagine. I will take that. We can move mountains with that. So I think what's amazing about the tension of prayer is that prayer is God equipping us by stripping us. And I think we see that come out not only here, but all throughout Scripture in general. So what we want to do at this point is we want to give you a chance to hit pause and reflect on some questions that we are going to put on the screen for you to reflect on them individually or to talk about them with those that you are with. And after that, we're going to sing a song. It's one of our newer favorites here at Kettlebrook as a family of faith called Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me, which at the heart of this scripture, Martha, as you said, who's this about? It's not about them. It's about Christ in them, if you would, and through them. So we're going to sing about that after we take some time to reflect and discuss.
Is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can't sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me through the deepest valley. Been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Well, we pray that that was a fruitful discussion for you. One of the things we talked about in the first section was some of the tensions that we saw in this text. And now I want to flesh out a few of the implications of the text that we see. Steve, what are one of the implications that you see?
I think, Troy, one of the implications is, and it's bad news, is that Matthew is a Jew writing to Jews who are religious people. Mm. And his challenge to them is, we can't rely on our own religiosity, our own religiousness, our churchianity, if sure. we put it into our language. A lot of times when I'm talking with folks who are coming, they're saying, well, I went to church, but they leave Jesus out. Mm. It's not a relationship with Jesus, it's I'm going to church. And what Matthew is saying to us as religious people, West Bend religious people, Washington County a religious people. We're a Christian nation, aren't we? We're religious. We go to church. Is he saying, don't leave Jesus out of the equation because it's powerless without Jesus. Jesus is the center. It's about Jesus. And so the bad news, don't trust in ourselves. Don't trust in what we can accomplish. Trust in Jesus. Have that little grain of faith that Jesus can take, and then, as you said before, move mountains.
Yeah. So that's the bad news that we see.
Correct.
That Matthew's bringing out. Not only just to everybody else, but I think to himself, acknowledging again.
Yes.
Hey, I'm part
yes.
of this.
Yes.
Martha, what's another implication? Is there good news in here?
There's good news. The good news is the mustard seed. We just need a mustard seed worth of faith. I used to read that backwards. I used to think that meant if I looked at my circumstances and my prayers weren't being answered the way I wanted, that meant I didn't have any faith at all. I didn't even have a mustard seed worth of faith. But this is not what that mustard seed means. It means we just need the littlest bit of faith, and Jesus does all the rest with that. So we can just come in prayer. That's a mustard seed. Just getting down on our knees and praying, that's exercising a mustard seed of faith. Or just fasting for something, that's exercising a mustard seed of faith. It really is that little.
Yeah. I really like the way that you said you saw that backwards. Mm. I think people, we can relate to that. Like, oh yeah, if I'm not getting this answer, therefore I must have zero faith or the faith of a mustard seed. And Jesus here is saying, if you have this faith, I can move mountains, and seeing it in a hopeful light.
Yeah.
Again, just taking that nugget, that tiny seed. And late, you know, other places he says that tiny seed will grow into the greatest tree, if you would, of the garden plants.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful thing. So that's good news. The other good news implication that I see in this is the words, bring the boy here to me. Bring the boy here to me. In the midst of, you unbelieving and perverse generation, how long, bring him here. Bring him to me. And that's the gospel. That's the gospel. The bad news, hey, we think it's of our own power. We think it's of our own might. We think it's of our own strength. That's why we don't pray. We don't pray because we don't need to pray, because we've got everything under control.
I'm good.
But Jesus responds, I think, to that with, hey, we couldn't do this. Well, yeah, you can't do it. You're not getting it if you think that you can. Bring him here to me. And the scriptures, not just on this page, all throughout, are God the Father showing us that we are to bring ourselves and one another to Jesus. Bring ourselves and others to his feet, where he will take care of things in his timing, in his way, by his will, not ours, but he will deal with it.
Yep.
He will deal with it. And again, just that mustard seed of Martha, as you said, when we think about being equipped in prayer, it's us bringing ourselves to Jesus. It's us bringing ourselves before the throne of God, the Father in heaven. Jesus is our mediator, and he's given us the Spirit. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. This is what he asks of us. Bring him to me. And so in light of that, we want to sing a song that's called I Will Look Up. In other words, this is where we want to look up. We want to look to God. Mm-hmm. We want to look to the Father in the name of the Son and by the power of the Spirit. So let's take a second and stand and sing this song with us.
Jesus.
Prince of Peace, perfect healer, all my life, all my cares on you, King of Kings, mighty Savior, all my life, all my cares on you, Prince of Peace, perfect healer.
As we conclude our gathering this morning, we have just a couple of key takeaways that we wanted to consider as maybe next steps or applications in light of what we shared this morning. Steve, what do you have for us?
One is to pray. We left enough time, I think, today that where maybe after you finish with the video, you could pray together as a group, if you're gathering together as a group. Perfect time. The discussion this morning wasn't as long, maybe, so we wanted to leave a little bit of time to pray. Another thought I had is when you set your alarm for tomorrow morning, maybe you could set it a couple minutes earlier, maybe 10 minutes earlier, to just start that habit of having prayer every morning. I wouldn't give up that time of prayer in the morning. It's so good. It's so refreshing. It's so impactful. It really makes a difference.
Yeah. And I'd like to take that that challenge, if you would, to pray one step further. One of the things I hear so often is that people really hate praying out loud in front of other people.
Yeah.
So what I'd love to challenge you with in light of this is to go, could I take a step by praying out loud in front of somebody else? And the reason I think that it comes in this text a little bit is when the disciples say, why couldn't we? So collectively, they were saying, we couldn't do this. We'd mess this up.
Right.
There's an acknowledgement there, and that's okay.
Yeah.
And I think it's okay for us to be able to say to one another, hey, I don't know if I'm going to get this all right. I don't know how to do this very well, but I'm going to do this with you. In the midst of a time when we feel so separated, prayer is actually something that will draw us together. And the vulnerability and the intimacy of that and the humility of it. So I'd encourage you to take a step out and actually try to pray out loud with somebody else. That would be safe for you, but someone else. Thirdly, we have something called the Prayer Course. Martha, can you talk to us about that?
The Prayer Course is a website that you can go to. Very easy to find, just The Prayer Course. If you put that into your browser, it will come up. Theprayercourse.org is just a really great tool for learning more about prayer. It is broken down into 8 different sessions, It's a very relaxed discussion between two people about prayer, about some different themes in prayer. It also has a lot of resources for different ways to pray, and it's just full of really good, not only information, but tools for you if you want to explore more prayer and what you can do in prayer.
Yeah, yeah. And we also have some kits.
Great tool kits. So Grandpa Steve will just say, hey, this would be awesome for you kids to tell your parents, hey, could we do this? Could we set up some prayer stations? These are available. You take these home, and kids, you could set up the stations with mom and dad and then walk through these different prayer
activities.
Activities, yep. Thank you. It's like, well, it's a word that starts with A. Prayer activities. And it's outstanding. It gives you different opportunities to try different aspects and activities in prayer.
Yeah. We'll sanitize it before we send it out with you, and you can sanitize it when he comes back. Lastly, what we've been doing is we're doing Kahoots. There's little quizzes. They're fun. You could do those individually or with your family. There'll be a Kahoot after this one as well. It's about prayer. It's about this text that we talked about. So those are some things we want to do to continue to inspire us and equip us as Jesus wants to be equipping us in prayer as a family. So why don't we stand in conclusion? Just want to read these words from Jesus to you and to ourselves. He says, I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will be moved. Nothing will be impossible for you. Family, may we understand that in prayer, God will be able to do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, just like we see here, as we bring these things before the throne. So let's go do that together as we are equipped by Jesus in this time. God bless you, and have a great week.
Amen.